By the summer of 1989, people in Hungary, Czechoslovakia, Poland, and here in Yugoslavia had lived under communist rule for more than 40 years. They had no idea that the ideology which had so dominated their lives was about to be swept away in a revolution that some would celebrate as the end of history. When the Berlin Wall finally fell on November the 9th, the 20th century seemed to have reached its climax. The moment that marked the triumph of the West. With the collapse of communism in Eastern Europe and the breakup just 2 years later of the Soviet Union itself, it seemed as if the Anglo-American model of capitalist democracy had won the day. Some people looked forward to a new world order, others anticipated the end of history. Finally, it seemed as if all the problems of the 20th century had been solved. Globalization suddenly seemed unstoppable, sweeping away both warfare states and welfare states. The extreme ideologies of communism and fascism were all washed up. And with the end of ideology, the world also looked forward to a new era of racial harmony. And then this happy ending was ruined. Events in Bosnia showed that there were still those ready and willing to engage in ethnic cleansing. Genocidal acts were committed all over the world as the Cold War faded from memory. Against the Tutsis of Rwanda. Against the Kurds of Iraq. These were like action replays of the most ghastly scenes of the 20th century's War of the World. It turned out that history hadn't ended. For none of the forces that had made the 20th century so violent had really gone away. Economic volatility, ethnic conflict, empires in decline. But the question that remained unanswered as the century ended was whether a new war of the world was in the making. A war that would make what happened in Bosnia seemed like a gangland feud. Century, Britannia had ruled the waves. And some 500 million of the Earth's peoples. But by the mid-1970s, after 3 decades of painful and protracted imperial decline, not much was left of either hope or glory in the not very united kingdom of no longer Great Britain and strife-torn Northern Ireland. The empire had long gone. Britain itself was on the slide.
The economy seemed to be in terminal decline. Britain was the sick man of Europe. My generation, the teenagers of the winter of discontent, veered between despondency and helpless mirth.
And then the sick man met an iron lady.
Everybody, let me know.
first sight, there might not seem to be much of a connection between the Clash and Thatcherism. But punk rock and the conservatism that she espoused were two facets of the same backlash against all that had gone wrong with post-war Britain. Despite their outward differences, Joe Strummer and Margaret Thatcher shared a confrontational style that some of us simply couldn't resist.
When Margaret Thatcher became Prime Minister in May 1979, it marked the start of a very British revolution.
Let Labour's Orwellian nightmare of the left be the spur for us to dedicate with a new urgency our every ounce of energy and moral strength to rebuild the fortunes of this free nation.
The radicalism of Thatcher's economic policies was breathtaking. She confronted the unions. She privatised state-owned industries.
I'm making more money now, yeah.
And then she slashed income tax. This wasn't the end of history, but it was the end of the welfare state. And it wasn't just on the home front that Thatcher was fighting and winning battles. According to her admirers, the greatest victory of all was won abroad. The final, decisive round of the Cold War. It's sometimes assumed these days that the Soviet threat must have been exaggerated by conservatives in the 1980s. Some say the USSR was bound to self-destruct because of its chronic economic inefficiency. In reality, the Russian Empire, despite the faded revolutionary symbolism, still looked dauntingly powerful during the 1980s. The planned economy seemed well able to match the United States when it came to producing military power. Communism wasn't going to lay down and die. It had to be killed off. But Thatcher could not do this alone. She needed a partner. And that man was Ronald Reagan, Clark Gable, to Maggie's Vivian Lee. It was Reagan and Thatcher's hawkish defense policy that pushed the Soviet Union over the edge. From overstretch to collapse. At least, that's what their acolytes would have you believe. But it wasn't as simple as that. The true architect of the Soviet collapse needs to be sought inside, not outside the communist system. His name was Mikhail Gorbachev. Gorbachev had two good ideas. He liberalized the Soviet economy, perestroika, and he called for more open political debate, glasnost. The problem was that the combination of the two proved fatal. The fear that had held the system together for so long, fear of the imperialist enemy, but above all, fear of the party, quite suddenly evaporated.
Some empires, like the Roman, take centuries to decline and fall. Others, like the British, take decades. But the decline and fall of the Soviet Empire all took place within the space of just 2 years. The first symptoms of its demise were economic. The reforms of Gorbachev didn't save the planned economy. They caused it to disintegrate.
Then there were the political aftershocks of Gorbachev's reforms, which swept across the periphery of the Soviet Empire. A wave of mostly peaceful nationalist revolutions in Eastern Europe swept away the old apparatchiks.
So it wasn't the triumph of the West that destroyed the Soviet Union. It was reform from above. Reform that ran wildly out of control and turned into full-blown revolution. Nothing in modern history illustrates better the old adage that the worst time for a bad regime is when it tries to reform itself.
As Margaret Thatcher savoured her moment of triumph in Moscow, it only remained for the victorious West to spend the expected peace dividend on the mother of all parties. Right? Wrong. In fact, the fall of the Soviet Union had, like the fall of all other empires before it, signaled not the end of history, but the re-emergence of old hatreds. It seemed for a time as if the collapse of communism in Eastern Europe in 1989 had ushered in a new era in which liberal democracy was the only show in town. Yet for 10 bloody years, one country sought to disprove this theory. When the Soviet Empire crumbled, the six republics that had made up Tito's Yugoslavia opted not for peace and democracy, but for a return to the vicious ethnic violence of the mid-20th century. Events in the Balkans after 1989 offered a salutary reminder that history was not over yet. History, it seemed, didn't want to end. It wanted to go right back to the century's beginning.
There are two monuments to Serbian nationalism here in Sarajevo, and this is one of them. It's the tomb of the assassins of the Austrian Archduke Franz Ferdinand. Their aim in 1914 was to liberate Bosnia from Austrian rule and create a new South Slav state. And in a way, they succeeded. But they also plunged the world into a terrible war, one that effectively ended the first age of globalization and condemned the Balkans to decades of bitter strife.
Across the road from the Christian cemetery where the assassins are buried, and in the shadow of that universal symbol of international togetherness from the Winter Olympics of 1984, is a second monument to Serbian nationalism. The graves of thousands of Sarajevo's citizens, murdered by forces loyal to the Serbian president, Slobodan Milosevic, and his Bosnian Serb confederates. On April the 5th, 1992, 100,000 people marched through the streets of Sarajevo to demonstrate for peace. The next day, the first mortars were fired from Serbian positions in the hills surrounding the city. For nearly 4 years, United Nations planes carrying food arrived at the airport at one end of the city, while the other end was being bombarded by Serbian artillery. At the time, British politicians strongly opposed any kind of intervention to halt this bloodshed, even to arm the people of Sarajevo so that they could at least defend themselves. It wasn't the first time in the 20th century that crimes against humanity were helped rather than hindered by Western diplomacy.
While the world looked on, nearly 12,000 people were killed here in Sarajevo in a siege that lasted 1,200 days. There were so many bodies, they had to turn this sports field next to the Olympic Stadium into a cemetery.
On June the 28th, 1989, Milosevic had made a speech that seemed deliberately aimed to stir up Serbian nationalist feeling against the other nationalities within the Yugoslav Confederation. Why did he do it? The answer is that this seemed to be the one way a communist leader could stay in power after 1989, by playing the card of ethnic hatred. Milosevic and the Croatian leader Franjo Tudjman agreed to carve up Bosnia between themselves. There would be, in Tudjman's words, no Muslim part. Yet nearly two-fifths of the population of Bosnia were Muslims. In 1992, Serb-controlled paramilitary death squads with names like the Tigers and the White Eagles swept through eastern Bosnia. Their aim wasn't merely to drive the Bosnian Muslims from their homes. Their aim was genocide. At the end of April, the Serbs reached Visegrad. Ivo Andrić won the Nobel Prize for Literature for his novel about this bridge over the River Drina. Andrić describes how the bridge was built in the 16th century at the height of the Ottoman Empire, only to end up on the fault line between East and West as that empire declined. In the first half of the 20th century, the bridge was a through route for warring armies. Yet in the years after 1945, people here enjoyed an uneasy but enduring peace. There were churches next to mosques, but this was a fairly secular culture. Around a quarter of marriages were mixed. The people of Visegrad came to see themselves as Yugoslavs, not as Serbs or Bosniaks, Orthodox or Muslim. So intermingled were the people of Bosnia that their separation could only be achieved by the most horrific violence.
On July the 11th, 1992, a red Volkswagen Passat drove out onto this historic bridge on the River Drina and pulled up here in the middle, at the Kapja, where for five centuries the local townspeople had met to gossip. Crammed inside the car were six Muslims and one heavily armed Serb. There was already a group of Serbs here waiting for them. Their leader had a message for the local Muslims.
According to an eyewitness, he announced over a megaphone to Muslims hiding in the surrounding woods that they would have a bloody holiday, Balkan style. He also announced that every Serb who protects a Muslim will be killed immediately, and that for every Serb killed by a Muslim, 1,000 Muslims would be sacrificed.
According to the same witness, the Serbs then cut off the heads of the six Muslim prisoners and threw their bodies in the Drina. Half an hour later, another eight Muslims were delivered to the bridge. They were dispatched in the same manner. The third consignment included women and children. The killing went on all night.
It was the river that brought the first signs of the massacre in Visegrad to neighbouring villages. A dead body was found floating in the water a couple of miles downstream. Over the next few months, the corpses of more than 100 men, women and children were dragged from the river. Nearly 1,600 of Visegrad's Muslims are listed as killed or missing. Today, only 100 remain. This pattern of systematic murder was repeated in towns and villages right across Bosnia. 92,000 people are listed on this database as either dead or missing. These people were murdered because their killers regarded them as racially inferior to themselves. To Orthodox Christian Serbs, Bosnian Muslims were somehow aliens. Nothing could be further from the truth.
Here at the Lukovic Reassociation Centre, they're using DNA testing to try to identify the individual victims of ethnic cleansing. The irony is that although these DNA tests can tell you whether bones like these belonged to a particular individual, what they can't tell you is whether that individual was a Bosnian or a Serb or a Croat.
As with the Jews in interwar Germany, it almost seemed as if the more integrated different groups were, the greater the potential for conflict. In Bosnia, the absence of biological differences didn't prevent an ethnic conflict.
Indeed, one thing the Serbs did in Visegrad had the effect of further confusing ethnic identities in Bosnia.
A recurrent feature of 20th century violence, from Nanjing in 1937 to Berlin in 1945 to Visegrad in 1992, has been the way murder has so often been accompanied by rape. The UN Commission on Human Rights called the incidence of rape in Bosnia massive, organized, and systematic. It was used not only as an instrument of war, but as a method of ethnic cleansing intended to humiliate, shame, degrade, and terrify the entire ethnic group. ...200 women and girls were snatched from their homes in Visegrad by members of the White Eagles squad and taken to this hotel, a health spa that specializes in sporting injuries. The women were repeatedly raped in these rooms. Similar crimes were committed at the fire station, the Bikovac Hotel, the sports center. Every Muslim woman in Visegrad was a target. The European Union says that altogether 20,000 women were raped during the war. The Bosnian government says 50,000. No one really knows. Some of the victims were murdered, but not all. Some, again we can't be sure how many, became pregnant.
It was as if the perpetrators of crimes like the ones committed at this hotel had reverted to the crudest kind of tribal behaviour. It wasn't enough for them simply to kill Muslims. They also had to impregnate their womenfolk, as if trying to increase the Serbian share not just of Bosnia's land, but also of its gene pool. And yet such crude conduct coincided with subtle political calculation. Milosevic cynically played the card of extreme Serbian nationalism to avoid the fates of those other East European communist leaders who had been swept away by the wave of post-1989 nationalism. Milosevic resolved to ride that wave, indeed to whip it up, and for a time, to be precise for 10 years, it worked.
Some fool said the hour of Europe had dawned in Bosnia, as if Brussels could somehow halt the killing. In fact, it took American firepower to do that. And it was American firepower that stopped and then reversed the ethnic cleansing Milosevic also attempted in the province of Kosovo.
With Milosevic finally gone, Europe and presumably also the bridge and the river Drina could breathe a sigh of relief. History had, after all, ended in the Balkans too, just a little bit later than everywhere else. And yet the collapse of the Soviet Union and its subsequent aftershocks were in many ways distracting people from far more profound changes that were going on the other side of the world. There, another communist party was working out how to have economic change without making political concessions. And this empire, far from breaking up into its component parts, was planning to expand and to pose a new and formidable threat to the West.
When When the Berlin Wall came down in 1989, the optimists who so confidently prophesied the end of history had clearly missed the consequences of the other revolutions that had happened 10 years previously.
For Thatcherism wasn't the only product of the Annus Mirabilis of 1979. Three other revolutions were just as important, if not more so, and it was their explosive interaction that determined the outcome of the 20th century. Not to mention the beginning of the 21st. Did they in fact portend not the triumph of the West, but a new war of the world?
A 100 years ago, it was Japan that posed the economic and military challenge to Western dominance in Asia. Today, it's China. Since the mid-1990s, China has had the fastest-growing free market economy in the world. In fact, it may be the fastest-growing economy in all history. Yet China remains one of the few countries in the world still ruled by communists. Just how was it that the Chinese communists were able to embrace capitalism without sacrificing their monopoly on power? The simple answer is that when a revolutionary situation developed in 1989, the regime did what communist regimes had routinely done. It sent in the tanks. On June the 4th, 1989, the Democracy Wall movement was ruthlessly suppressed. Untold numbers of the students who'd gathered in Tiananmen Square were killed by soldiers brought in from the provinces. Leading dissidents were jailed after show trials.
There was a striking difference between what happened here and what happened in the other great communist monolith, the Soviet Union. There, they tried to have political reform and economic reconstruction simultaneously, but they ended up with a political revolution and economic collapse. The key point was that the Chinese leadership wanted to have economic reconstruction without any political reform. Anyone who thought that was a victory for the West was dreaming.
Yet it would be a mistake to think that China's communists owed their success simply to the fact that they crushed a potential revolution in 1989. Far more important was the revolution they themselves had initiated 10 years before. A revolution with far more profound consequences. The achievements of the Chinese Revolution of 1979 are dazzling indeed. Running beneath the Huangpua River in Shanghai, this tunnel is one of the more bizarre symbols of the Chinese free market miracle. A kind of oriental magical mystery tour.
This is Jin Mao Tower, the 88-storey crowning glory of a forest of skyscrapers that sprung up here in Shanghai's Pudong district in the space of just 15 years. It's so big that, frankly, it makes London's docklands look a little bit like Legoland. But the incredible thing is that all of this is the achievement not of Thatcherites, but of card-carrying communists. The man who set this economic miracle in train was the same man who sent the tanks into Tiananmen Square. Deng Xiaoping.
At 74, Deng was the arch survivor of the Chinese Revolution. He'd accompanied Mao on the Long March and had survived the dark days of the Cultural Revolution. Twice after his rehabilitation, the Gang of Four, led by Mao's toxic wife Jiang Qing, had tried to get rid of him. But Deng had come out on top. And if it wasn't for the revolution he set in motion in 1979, Jin Mao Tower might never have been built. Mao Zedong had ruled China since 1949 on the Soviet model of the rigidly planned economy. What he called his great leap forward had been a great leap backward, costing millions of lives. In contrast, Deng's strategy for a real leap forward was to break up state control and encourage private enterprise, while all the time ruthlessly maintaining the political apparatus of communism.
One of Deng Xiaoping's favorite sayings was an aphorism from his native Sichuan. It doesn't matter if the cat is black or white, as long as it catches mice.
To prove his point, Deng was even willing to make overtures to China's capitalist archenemy.
These hats are presented to His Excellency Deng Xiaoping.
When Deng arrived in America on January the 28th, 1979, the same year Margaret Thatcher came to power in Britain, it was the first time that a leader of communist China had visited the United States. And here he was, all 5 feet of him, donning a 10-gallon hat in Texas. The crucial thing about Deng's US trip was to ensure that Chinese exports would have access to the American market. In return, American firms would be allowed to invest in the free trading zones created by Deng in China.
The United States thought it could turn China into a kind of American subsidiary in a replay of the 1920s. Instead, it found itself facing a titanic economic rival.
In China, economic reconstruction without political reform turned out to be the ideal formula for growth. By the late 1990s, some Western economists were forecasting that China's economy would overtake that of the United States by 2041. Anxious observers began to wonder if this economic competition might lead to conflict. There was nervous talk of future trade wars. And not only trade wars. For it's not all that difficult to imagine a clash between East and West that would dwarf the Russo-Japanese War of 1904, the conflict that marked the start of the War of the World. What if there were a setback to economic growth in China? Rather than risk popular protests, might the Chinese communists be tempted, like Milosevic before them, to divert people's attention by playing the nationalist card? The obvious flashpoint for an East-West collision would be Taiwan, which China regards as an integral part of the People's Republic, but whose autonomy the United States is committed to defending. Here is a potentially fatal flashpoint for a new millennium. And yet, despite the growing risk of a new superpower collision in Asia, Deng Xiaoping's was not the most momentous revolution of 1979.
After all, the Chinese were embracing at least part of what we think of as Western culture, the free market, albeit a Far Eastern version planned by a one-party state. In the Near East, by contrast, every aspect of Western culture was being repudiated. There, it wasn't so much about profits as about the profit. And whereas the Chinese were exporting products, the Muslim world was exporting people.
In a year of revolutions, 1979 had brought a woman to power in England. A woman wholly committed to the idea that salvation lay in the free market. But 1979 also brought the Ayatollah Khomeini to power in Iran. A man just as committed to the idea that salvation lay in the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad. One revolution pointed to a world based on free trade, the other to a world based on holy writ.
The Iranian Revolution was partly a matter of settling scores with the Shah and with the United States, which had put him in power. But under Khomeini's leadership, the aim became to turn the clock back, to purge Iranian society of all traces of Western corruption, and to challenge American pretensions not just in the Middle East, but throughout the Islamic world.
What was happening was much more than just a religious revival of Islam. Islamism was a militantly political movement. Indeed, it was as revolutionary an ideology as Bolshevism, which had spread around the globe like an epidemic after the First World War.
But the greatest strength of radical Islam was that it had demography on its side. The Western societies against which the mullahs had declared holy war simply couldn't compete when it came to raw reproduction. And that was because the fundamentalists took the most reactionary view possible of the role of women in society. In the Ayatollah's Iran, a woman's place was either in the home or in the maternity ward.
This helps to explain the fourth and largely unnoticed revolution of 1979. Along with the upheavals in Britain, China, and Iran, came a demographic revolution in Europe. In Iran, when contraception and abortion were banned and the age of consent for marriage was lowered to just 13 years, the result was a population explosion. Yet in Western societies, where women had access to birth control, the opposite was happening. Populations were beginning to shrink. The consequences of this divergence were dramatic. In Iran, the annual rate of population growth is now more than 7 times higher than in Britain.
But it wasn't the increased mortality of a war or a plague that caused Europe's demographic decline. It was reduced fertility. By the 1970s, the average West European couple was having fewer than 2 children. Now, to keep a population stable, that number needs to be more than 2. By 1999, it was down to 1.3. Europeans, quite simply, were failing to reproduce themselves.
That begged one fundamental question. Who was going to pay the taxes necessary to fund old Europe's generous state pensions? Either newborn Europeans would spend their working lives paying 75% tax rates, or their parents would have to tolerate more legal immigration. A lot more.
But where would the new immigrants come from? Obviously, a high proportion would have to come from neighbouring countries. But Eastern Europe clearly couldn't supply sufficient numbers. Indeed, the United Nations projected the population of Eastern Europe to fall by as much as a quarter over the next 4.5 decades. Those who were expecting waves of migrants from that direction were simply facing the wrong way, east, when they should have been looking south.
This is the front line of Fortress Europe. The dividing line between Europe's declining population and her fastest growing neighbours. countries that by the end of the 1990s were predominantly, if not wholly, Muslim. These CCTV images capture what is an almost daily event at the newly fortified fence. The desperate attempts of migrants to cross from North Africa to Europe. Economically, Europe needs these migrants. But Europeans feel distinctly nervous about the cultural transformation their presence implies. This is the new face of what some call Eurabia. What you see here in southern Spain is happening to varying degrees all over Europe. A youthful Muslim society is quietly colonizing an increasingly decrepit Europe. 100 years ago, the frontier between West and East was located somewhere in the vicinity of Sarajevo. Today, it seems to run through every European city.
Of course, no one can predict the future, least of all a historian whose business is supposed to be the past. And yet it was a historian, Edward Gibbon, who first tried to visualise what a Muslim England might actually look like, complete with minarets in the centre of Oxford. Gibbon was probably just trying to amuse his readers, or possibly to poke fun at his old university. And yet today, the minarets are right here in the heart of Oxford, symbolising better than anything else that fundamental reorientation that was the underlying trend of the 20th century.
This is the reality of globalisation. Goods, services, and most importantly, people moving in huge volumes between countries with all kinds of unforeseeable cultural consequences. Well, we've been here before. It seems a distant memory now, but 100 years ago, globalization was also the world order of the day. As goods, capital and labour flowed freely from the European empires to the ends of the earth, sailing in steamships or propelled overland by railways like the Trans-Siberian. Yet globalisation was accompanied by escalations in ethnic tension, which first manifested themselves in the Russo-Japanese War. And in 1914, this first age of globalization ended with a spectacular bang. Because of an act of terrorism in Sarajevo.
In the mayhem of World War, an extreme anti-capitalist sect gained control over Russia and her empire. In the succeeding decades, three diabolical dictators, Stalin, Hitler and Mao, rose to rule over vast tracts of the great Eurasian landmass that stretches from the English Channel to the China Sea. Their totalitarian regimes and the pseudo-religions they espoused were responsible for literally tens of millions of deaths. Could something similar befall the second age of globalization in which we live? Could the War of the World replay itself in the 21st century?
If we're to avoid history's repeating itself, we need to understand the root causes of the last 100 years' war. The 20th century revealed that despite unprecedented ethnic intermarriage, racial harmony wasn't guaranteed. Indeed, it was in precisely the places where assimilation had been greatest that some of the worst ethnic conflict occurred. in 1930s Germany, and in 1990s Bosnia. There were lethal backlashes against ethnic integration. Timing is crucial too. Such crises tended to happen during periods of economic upheaval, for that's when ethnic minorities are viewed with the most hostility. And where did the worst violence of the 20th century happen? It was on the fault lines, where declining empires and rising empire states came into conflict. It was no coincidence that the worst killing fields of the century were in places like Poland, Cambodia, and Bosnia. In this series, I've tried to show the elements that make up the formula for the War of the World. That it was ethnic disintegration, economic volatility, earthquakes on imperial frontiers that caused the greatest conflict and suffering in the 20th century. That's not to say that conflict is inevitable along these new fault lines. But it is to say that even where people seem well integrated, the fragile edifice of civilization can very quickly be demolished, and the old tribal urges unleashed.
It was as if some invisible jet flashed into white flame. The houses caved in as they dissolved at its touch.
On the eve of the 20th century, H.G. Wells had imagined a war of the worlds in which Martian invaders devastated the Earth. In the 100 years that followed, men proved that they could wreak comparable havoc without any need for alien intervention. All they had to do was to imagine this or that group of their fellow men as aliens. Well, the War of the Worlds remains in the realm of science fiction, but the War of the World is a historical fact. We'll only avoid another century of conflict if we truly understand the forces that caused the last one, the dark forces that conjure up ethnic conflict and imperial rivalry and negate our common humanity. They're forces that stir within us still.